Scheduled devotional leaders and none of them showed up, we'd be saying, now that's a shame.
Amen.
But since they were here and did as God led them to do,
Amen.
We ought to just say thank you, Lord, for every one of them.
Amen.
Tonight I want to ask you to open your Bibles to Exodus chapter 14, verse 15. Exodus chapter 14, verse 15. If you are there and ready to read, would you say amen?
Amen.
Won't you read that verse together?
And the Lord said unto Moses, Wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen.
And God said, if Wherefore criest thou unto me? Why are you crying on me? Calling on me. Speak to the children of Israel that they go forward. If I were preaching this text, I'd take Bernie Mac's words and title it, Bust a Move. The practice, and it's sad, this practice has been so successfully taught to generations, but the practice of substituting prayer for action is theologically incorrect.
Amen.
When there is an appropriate action to take, it's common for church folk to say, well, let's pray about it.
Amen.
Prayer takes the onus, when falsely used, takes the onus off the prayer and alleges it to be God's duty.
Right?
And God says, why are you crying on me? Moses has said in the preceding verses 13 and 14, to the people, fear not. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show you today. For the Egyptians, whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. And apparently some activity took place in between verse 14 and 15. But the activity was not moving the people forward.
Right.
His speech sounds very good, verse 13 and 14. But no action was taking place in verse 15. And God said, Wherefore criest thou unto me? So that when we understand the practice of prayer, prayer is an action. But it's not a substitute for other action. If you want to grow in the knowledge of God's word, prayer without study won't accomplish it.
All right.
There are some things we really ought not even pray about. Folly of me it would be if I prayed when I stood up to teach, Lord, do you want me to teach? That's already a foregone conclusion.
Right.
Foolish of me it would be if the week passed by and Sunday morning came and I said, well, Lord, I didn't work on a sermon because you didn't tell me if you wanted me to preach. Foolish. He's already made that clear. So when the assignment is clear and when the activity has been stated, praying can be used as a substitute for action. And oftentimes we are found paralyzed because we're praying when we ought to be moving. So then, who is served best by prayer? We've understood, we've seen, it's not God, because we midgets don't have an idea to present to him.
Amen.
That he hasn't thought of yet.
Amen.
So prayer doesn't benefit him. God is not stubbornly sitting on his throne waiting on us to beg him.
Thank you.
And if we beg him long enough, he'll feel sorry for us and give in. That's not the mindset of a loving father. God is not a judge or on the jury waiting for us to plead our case. And if we defend it well enough, we can persuade him. That would mean that we have the ability to change God's mind. And if I can change God's mind, I need not call him God. God is omniscient. He knows everything.
Amen.
And so prayer does not change God. Prayer changes the prayer.
Amen.
Amen.
And so oftentimes we know what we should do. And we know why we should do it. And prayer may help you gain the courage and focus to do it. But it should not be used to try to persuade God to do it in your place.
All right.
And so we talked about how vertical prayer is prayer to God. And that's always centering the attention on the mission. That's the first step we ought master if we're going to be effective in our prayer lives. What is my life's mission?
Mm-hmm.
Why am I here?
Amen.
And for all of us, the mission is the same. How it's carried out differs, but the mission is the same. Every one of us exists for God's glory.
Amen.
And so when we look even at this passage, and we'll get into more, but in this passage, verse 17, when God does announce what he will do, his announcement seems to be counterproductive. Moses and the children of Israel are scared. They are scared because Pharaoh and his army is in hot pursuit.
Amen.
Mountains are on both sides. Red Sea in front. Moses is crying to God, and God announces what he's going to do. Now let's back up and let's get a glimpse of this. Let's say I'm Moses, you're the children of Israel, and I've led you to the Red Sea, understanding that to be God's will.
All right.
The Red Sea is there. The mountains are on both sides. And we hear some noise behind us. And it's not friendly. Pharaoh and his army is pursuing us. And y'all start saying, oh, so you brought us out of here to die? It wasn't enough graves in Egypt?
All right.
And then I preach, God's going to deliver us. God's going to bring us. I stand still. Don't be afraid. And then when I finish preaching, you hear me say, Lord, please. Don't leave us out here, Lord. Please, come on. And God says to me, well, this is what I'll do. I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. I'm going to harden his heart so that they will follow after you. I was asking you to help us out, not to intensify the attack. Why are you going to do that, Lord? And he says, I'm going to do that because I'm going to get honor. Another word for honor in this is glory. I'm going to get glory. God is saying, I am not moving because y'all are afraid.
That's right.
I'm not even moving because y'all are in danger. I'm moving because this is the method I've selected to get glory.
Amen. All right.
Now, we can be afraid by focusing on our own safety. Or we can be courageous by focusing on his glory. Sometimes his glory leads us to unsafe environments. That's not popular, but it's the truth. Sometimes God gets the glory by allowing us to be in dangerous circumstances.
Amen. Yes, he does.
It may be that God is not getting much glory out of your life because you found too many safe spots to stay in.
All right.
And God is saying, I can't use you, man.
All right.
You found your safe spots, so in your safe spots, you draw in other folk who like the safe, comfortable spots so you can editorialize on those folk that's in danger.
Yeah. All right.
You should have stayed over here with us. I know what's wrong with them. What you don't realize is you are saved, but God's not getting any glory.
Right.
They're in danger, but God is using that for his glory.
Amen.
So then, you are safe now, but when you stand before him, you have nothing to be proud of. Because you just safely hid and did nothing. I have never, and I've used this analogy before, I have never, ever struck out in the major leagues. There's no pitcher anywhere at any time in history that can honestly say they struck me out in the major leagues. Nobody ever got me put out on base. The reason why it's never happened, because I ain't done nothing. Success is not the absence of failure. You can do nothing. That doesn't make you successful. It is the one that takes the chance and goes up to bat and swings at a ball and risks being put out and sometimes trying to steal bases, that's the one that becomes successful, but they put themselves in dangerous circumstances. They take risks in order to accomplish something worthy of honor.
Amen.
So Moses is crying to God, and God says to him, why? Move forward. Lift up your rod, stretch out your hand over the sea, divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. We saw the same principle demonstrated in other passages. One in particular is Mark chapter 9, verses 22 and 23. That man who had brought his son to Jesus, and he said, if you can do anything, have mercy on us, have compassion on us, and help us. And Jesus said, if you can, believe. All things are possible to them that believe. So Jesus puts the responsibility on the man.
Amen.
The failure of the man is that he had been living his whole life looking for somebody else to help him. I brought him to your disciples. They didn't hear. The scribes were there. They were discussing it. Very likely he brought them to the religious community. They didn't help him. And so now he says, ain't nobody helping him? Jesus, can you help? And Jesus said, well, when are you going to do something? So then, prayer is an action. It's an activity, but it's not a substitute for other activity. Yeah. It is to be utilized in concert with obedience.
All right.
The most powerful thing that God has given us is his word.
Amen.
And for us to grasp the importance of that would suggest that one of the high times of the believer's life would be Bible study night.
All right.
Because the best thing that God has left us with is his word.
All right.
There's absolutely nothing that God has given us any better than his word.
Amen.
Someone would say, well, Jesus is, but Jesus is the word.
Amen.
He has given us nothing any better than his word. And so prayer then is not a substitute for study.
Amen.
Prayer prepares the heart of the believer to recognize what God has said. You see, I can say something, and if I say something and you've heard it before, you can say, I recognize that. Yeah, he said that before. That's recognition. Then somebody can say, well, what did Pastor say? And then you can repeat it. That's recalling it. But it's only when you are able to remember it when it's time to apply it that it's really transformed your life.
Amen.
See, we can all quote and tote the Bible.
Right.
The issue is, can we apply it when it's appropriate?
Right.
And that's why rightly dividing the word becomes very important, because if you misinterpret it, then you will apply it incorrectly.
Amen.
Words are critically important. Just a few letters can make a major difference. There's a huge difference between a lightning bolt and a lightning bug. Just a few letters difference, but it can mean the world of a difference. You can catch a lightning bug in your hand and it does you no harm, but I wouldn't take that chance with a lightning bolt. And so words become critical, that we understand what the word says and what Christ is revealing. So we saw last week how prayer is for the light bulb to come on.
Amen.
You can hear something and it makes sense. And then you can read it and say, yeah, I've heard that before. And then when it's time to apply it, you go back to something you believed before you heard what you just heard. And so in that case, you have more knowledge, but it doesn't mean you have more wisdom.
Amen.
Wisdom is only the application of the knowledge. The light bulb has to go off so that you begin to see how this new information is to be applied.
Yes.
Now again, this is where many in Christendom mess up. We hear the message over and over again, and we hear it, and we shout off it, we rejoice over it, And it becomes a word for inspiration. And we forget that it's not designed to be a word for inspiration. It's designed to be a word for transformation,
right,
and application.
Amen.
We become professional shouters off the word. And then sometimes those outside the church apply better than we do. We say they're not spiritual because they don't shout. We think since they don't shout, they don't have the Holy Ghost. Which is unbiblical in and of itself.
Amen.
But that's what we've been taught.
Amen.
They don't have the Holy Ghost. And they are applying truth and getting better results than we are because we're shouting and waiting on God. And God is saying, why are you crying?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Do something.
Amen.
So then the Bible is filled with principles that when these principles are correctly practiced, they serve for our positive profit.
Yeah.
But it's not just being hearers of the word, but being doers also. So then, we saw last week that revelation informs the intellect. Let's just look at one of the passages we looked at on last week. Let's go to Colossians chapter 1. Looked at several, and I think this is one of the ones we got to, but if not, that's great, and if it is, that's good. Amen.
Amen.
Colossians chapter 1, and I'll begin reading at verse 25. If you're there, would you say amen?
Amen.
If you're not there, say I'm almost there. All right. All right. Now if you're there, would you say amen?
Amen.
All right. Verse 25, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God.
Amen.
Even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Amen. So it's in the mystery, it's in the word, it's in the truth. That's where God does his work. Let's look at one more, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. That's why it's important to remember that God always blesses his word.
Yes.
But not what we say about his word.
Amen.
His word. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. If you're there, would you say amen?
Amen.
Why don't you read verses 3 and 4 together?
But if thy gospel is evil, it is hid to them that are lost, and whom the God of this world hath blinded the eyes of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them.
Amen. Someone asked me today, what defense do we have of the faith to a person who says you need proof? And I told them what I told y'all Sunday, the resurrection, and gave the passages of scripture. And she said, well, that's what believers would believe, but what about unbelievers? I gave her that verse. They ain't gonna see it.
Right.
Not if their minds have been blinded.
Right.
There is no proof to the ones who can't see.
Amen.
Help me if you can.
Amen.
And so then, we are blessed that God has given us revelation.
Amen.
We ought to shout on a regular basis whenever we think about the fact that God turned the light on.
Amen.
That we see it.
Amen.
We do not see it because we are smart. We do not see it just because we were reared in a Christian home.
Yes, sir.
We do not see it just because we come to this church.
Amen.
There are blind people who were reared in Christian homes.
Amen.
There are blind people who attend good churches.
Amen.
There are blind people who have heard it, but they can't see it because the God of this world can blind them.
Amen.
So whenever we know that God has shown us the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, we ought to rejoice, not just because there is a gospel, that's enough to shout over it by itself, but rejoice also that he's opened our eyes and shown the light so that we can see it.
All right, amen, amen.
Hell, it should have been a shout right there.
Amen.
Thank God I can see it. That even when you don't feel like sharing the gospel in this world, you got to rejoice for a moment that thank God I have this gospel and I have believed this gospel. Even when you grow weary in well-doing, that the Bible says don't do it, but every now and then you do get weary in well-doing, you ought to take a praise break and say, well, thank God I see what the well-doing is and I've been busy on the battlefield. Just every now and then rejoicing that he turned the light on.
Yes.
And so this revelation informs the intellect so that now I know what the will of God is in my life. God's will is that my life would bring him glory. And so when I pray, Lord, your will be done. Because you know how you want to get glory even out of this.
Amen.
It may be uncomfortable to me. It may be frightening to me. It may be dangerous and risky to me. If I just think about me, I want you to give me an escape route. I want you to get me out of this mess. But Lord, if that's not the way you're going to get glory, give me strength to endure it until you can get some glory out of it. That's why we talk about heaven and rejoice about heaven, because some of the things that we won't get here. But there is a guarantee that some glad morning. There is a bright side somewhere. And so if I don't get it here, I'm okay because I'll get it throughout eternity when I leave here.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Revelation informs the intellect, but revelation also informs the will.
All right.
That is, now that I know what God's will is, that begins to progressively change my will.
Yeah.
That's why faith cometh by hearing. Context of that is not hearing it one time. The context is you just keep rehearing. Rehearsing is to rehear. You hear the way it ought to sound, and then you hear it again, and now you come and sing it that way, and if you sing it wrong, you have to stop so that you can get it right, because it does you no good to practice it wrong and then expect to sing it right. And so faith cometh by hearing it right and then hearing it again and hearing it again until it becomes who you are. And so when I first discover the will of God often clashes with my wish. But I come to the word and I come to church not to hear my wish again, but to hear his will again. And then as I hear his will over and over again, his will becomes my will. Let's look at Psalm 1. Psalm 1, verse 2. If you're there, would you say amen?
Amen.
Why don't you read that verse together?
Where his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night.
Amen. So it's not that he knows or he's heard the word, but he takes pleasure. He's got a new will now. His desire is the word. And he desires the word so much, he meditates. When he's woke, he's reading it. And when his eyes are closed, he's thinking about it. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 2. And see, that's how congregations can be composed of people with different socioeconomic backgrounds, different academic achievements, different races, all of that, and we still be on one accord.
Amen.
Because despite the external differences, his will has become our will.
Amen.
Amen.
We might see things a little different. We may have different experiences. But one thing we have in common is we want his will to be done.
Amen.
Proverbs chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. Let us read those verses together. My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding, yea, if thou criest after knowledge, and lifteth up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver, and searchest for her as for hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord, and find the knowledge of God. Amen. So it is learning to love God's word so much so that you take pleasure in his will. Our attitude should not be, oh Lord, we got to go to church again. But it should be, praise God.
Amen.
We get to go to church again. The psalmist says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. When your attitude is, I can watch TV all day. I can be on the phone and talk all day. But I sure hope Pastor don't preach long. Clearly, your will is different than his will.
Amen. All right.
And here is what the church should not be. It should not be a place that reinforces the wrong will.
Amen. All right.
See, something is wrong when a person can say, I hope church don't last long, and the person next to him say, child, I know. Sometimes I'm getting up walking out. Okay. Somebody else said, I know that's right. Now you got a whole congregation reinforcing something that is against God's will.
Amen.
And God cannot bless that because it's not his will. So then, we have to take delight in the word. See, the attitude should be, literally, I know we can't stay all night. But good Lord, if I didn't have to go to work and if I didn't have to do other things, I sure wish we would. That should be the attitude. I love the word. We'll stay in a movie for 2 hours and get there on time to watch the preview. But a 30-minute Bible lesson. Oh, well, come on now. Bring it in, preacher. And you should be honest enough to admit to yourself if that's your will, but then also honest enough to say, but that can't be God's will.
Amen.
And so then the church begins to experience transformation when we on one accord have the will of God.
Amen.
The choir comes to rehearsal, not with the attitude, well, you know, if I'm being a choir, I need to go to rehearsal, but I ain't getting there on time.
Amen,
Pastor. I sure hope they don't be rehearsing all night.
Oh, my goodness.
How can you have a full-time production with part-time acting?
Amen. All right.
Come on.
There has to be delight and joy. It would be a sad indictment, and I'm sure that you would agree with me. It would be a sad indictment if you heard me say, I hate preaching, but I know I gotta do it.
Yes, it would be.
It was raining and stuff. I was hoping that nobody showed up. That would be a sad night. And yet so many others in the congregation have the same attitude
Amen.
Towards what they do.
Amen.
We ought to take joy
yeah.
in serving the Lord. Our will should be informed by His word.
Yeah.
And then when we get His word informing our intellect and our intellect informing our will, then we find ourselves passionate.
Amen.
We love His will and His word. That yes, I'm facing this challenge, this dangerous dilemma, and I wanted God to rescue me out of it, but you know what? I realize that if I can keep my eyes on Him,
right.
He's going to be glorified.
Yes, He is.
So, Lord, I'm not going to ask you to take me out of this now. I'm just going to ask you to help me stay focused.
Yes,
help me to keep my mind stayed on you. Help me to stay focused so that I see you. So that if I can see you and I keep my eyes on the bullseye, then I can have joy even in the midst of this circumstance. And if I have joy and the enemy see my joy even in the midst of this circumstance, at some point they're going to wonder where I get this joy from. And if they ask me, I'm going to tell them this joy I have. The world didn't give it and the world can't take it away. Because John 15:11, Jesus says, these things have I spoken, which means it goes right back to the word. These things have I spoken that my joy might remain in you and that your joy may be full. Do I want joy? Yes, I want joy. But I don't get joy because I got confetti falling on my head. I got joy because I heard what He had to say. I get joy when I think about what God has done for me and who He is to me. And when I get that information, it brings about transformation. And that transformation produces a different application. So somebody says, I'm on the rough side of the mountain. I don't know if I'm gonna make it. But I say to you, get you some joy. And I know you want to say, well, I'm still praying. I'm still asking the Lord to help me. No, that ain't what you ought to be doing. Stop crying.
Yeah.
Hear what the Lord has said and start acting on what the Lord has said. You don't have to see a solid ground, but if He says get out the boat, walk on water. Because if you walk on water and His word, water can hold you up.
Hey!
I said, hey!
Hey! Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Come on.
Heads are bowed, eyes are closed.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, God, keep talking to us.
Please.
Speak to us.
Speak to us.
Until we want what you want.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
We're through using prayer trying to change your mind.
Amen.
We're using prayer so that our minds
yes.
can be conformed to your word.
Yes.
Lord, there's some here now that's in some unpleasant situation. And they've been begging you to get them out. But Lord, change their will so that their desire is not that you would get them out,
yes,
but that your glory would
yes,
show
sir.
Forth in it.
Yes,
give them joy.
Joy.
Because it's not what happens to us, but how we handle
yes.
what happens to us.
Yes.
So Lord, keep talking to us.
Please.
Until our will becomes identical to yours.
Yes.
And then make us passionate people.
Uh-huh.
So that even when our enemies would wait to see us fall, they find themselves watching us get stronger.
All right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Because you prepare a table before
thank
us
you.
Yes.
Thank you.
In the presence of our
thank
enemies.
You. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord, for your word.
Thank you for your word.
By faith,
amen.
We will be transformed progressively by your word.
Amen.
So that we would obediently respond to that word. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to us tonight.
Thank you, Lord.
And I pray to God that every hearer will give honest response to you as it relates to what you've said to them.
Yes,
Lord.
It's in the matchless name of Jesus we pray.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
As we stand together, the privilege of the church is extended. The doors of the church are open to any person who perhaps has failed up to now.